And in continuum to our series of the charge and discharge part 7, that is, we had discussed that it will be on 8 parts. So the 7th part is there. As I say, 7th, 8th of the series would be over. Section 208 of CRPC, which is an important aspect for the understanding as to why the separate charges for distinct offenses is required. And as usual, the speaker would be Justice B. Ramkumar, the former judge from Kerala High Court, an erudite speaker coupled with the fact that his explanation and deciphering of law is to the simplest form. And that's why his sessions are very, very simplified and liked by one and all. Amongst us, we also have Mr. K.V.J. Rao, himself a popular speaker and an aviation law expert. And it's a very surprising fact that despite the fact that he has not done law, but yet his understandings on the aviation law and making it simplified is also well received. And we will connect with him. We will bring one of the sessions with him on the aviation law. And that day, we will request Justice Ramkumar to participate to the contrary. Yes, sir. Over to you, sir.
Thank you, Mr. Vikas. Good evening, friends. We enter part 7 of charge discharge. Let me, before considering section 218 of CRPC, make a quick recap on the topics already covered during the previous session. Friends, we have already seen that we have seen the nature of power of the court under section 216 CRPC for adding to or altering a charge already framed. We also saw that the charges can be altered by the trial court at any stage of the proceedings, but before pronouncing the final judgment. It was noted that since adding to or altering a charge presupposes the existence of a charge, there is no question of altering a charge in respect of an accused who has already been discharged. Because once an accused is discharged, he goes out of the array of parties. Therefore, there is no question of altering the charge as against him. We saw that if the alteration or addition to a charge is likely to prejudice the accused or the prosecutor, the court has the discretion to direct a retrial under section 216, clause 4 CRPC. Because if by altering the charge, there is a likelihood of prejudice, either for the accused or for the prosecution, court has got the power under section clause 4 of section 216 to order a retrial. It was noticed that the power under section 216 CRPC can be exercised by an appellate court also. After all, appeal is only a continuation of the trial. In what all situations can the appellate court order retrial was also considered in the previous session. We, however, noted that in the absence of any material before the trial court, an appellate court cannot direct the trial court to alter the charge. Such a direction cannot be given when there is a lack of adequate materials before the trial court. It was found that the expression any court in section 216 CRPC is wide enough to take in a designated court under the TADA Act of 1987. We took notice of the fact that in the absence of a special procedure prescribed by the TADA Act, we have to follow CRPC by virtue of section 4.2 CRPC. Because under any special law, if the special law does not prescribe a special procedure, then you fall back upon CRPC itself as mandated by section 4.2. It was seen that section 216 is applicable even to cases instituted on a private complaint. So even in cases instituted on a private complaint, court has got the power to add to or alter the charge. Then it was also found that once the charge is altered or added to, court has to read and explain to the accused the altered charge. We also saw that just as the court is bound to hear the submissions of the public prosecutor and the submissions of the accused at the time of originally framing the charge or passing a discharge. In the case of, because while considering the record of the case, we noted that the court has to hear the submissions of the accused as well as the prosecution but only with regard to the documents produced by the prosecution. In that case, the same procedure will have to be followed while altering the charge also, because after all, the charge is being altered. Same procedure. So the accused has to be heard, prosecution also has to be heard. But only Ryder is hearing confined to the materials produced by the prosecution. Accused cannot adduce any material. We saw that de novo trial is not a must in every case of altering charge, and it is within the discretion of the court. Because if the court feels that the accused is bound to prejudice, then court may order de novo trial of the. It was seen that if either the prosecution or the defense does not make a request to recall or resummon the or re-examine the witnesses already examined under Section 217 CRPC, there is no duty cast on the court to sue or to ask the prosecutor or the accused whether he is exercising any right to recall any witness under Section 217 CRPC. Because of the word allow, because allow means, can you allow me to come in? That means I seek for your permission. Therefore, it is only when the concerned party, whether prosecution or the accused, wants to recall, they will have to make a request and the court will allow. Court has no suo motu duty to call for, to ask the accused or the prosecution whether he has got any witness to be recalled. We have noted a full bench of the Kerala High Court in that connection. Today, we will be exploring the contours of Section 218, leaving Sections 219 to 221 and 223, and also the exceptions, which are exceptions to Section 218. And Section 222 to 224 also will be considered in separate session. I'm afraid whether we will be able to complete the whole session in the next session. Probably we may require two more sessions instead of one.
Okay. Mine is lucky mascot.
Okay. We will now. Can anybody read Section 218? You see, look at the chart which I have.
We are sharing it.
Yes. I have given a chart to see that chart gives Sections 211 to 217 in column 1 and Sections 218 to 224 in column 2. See, the distinction is 211 to 217 falls under Part A of Chapter 17, which is mainly concerned with the form of charges, whereas 218 to 224 is joinder of charges. It has nothing to do with form of charges. So we are now entering 218, which is the first section in Part B of Chapter 17. Separate charge for distinct offense. Now please read Section 218 for everybody to.
Section 218, yes. Separate charges for distinct offenses. For every distinct offense of which any person is accused, there shall be a separate charge, and every such charge shall be tried separately, provided that with the accused person by an application in writing so desires, and the magistrate is of the opinion that such person is not likely to be prejudiced. Thereby, the magistrate may try together all or any number of the charges framed against such person. Nothing in subsection 1 shall affect the operation of the provisions of section 219, 220, 221, and 223. Illustration. A is accused of a theft on one occasion and of causing grievous hurt on another occasion. A must be separately charged and separately tried for the theft and causing grievous hurt. As already noticed, section 218 to 224 CRPC fall under Part B of Chapter 17 of CRPC. Dealing with the joint of charges.
Refer to chart C, already supplied to you. Now see, the illustration itself is very clear. Both the offenses were not committed as part of the same transaction. There is no unity of distance, unity of time. Therefore, they have to be separately tried. That is the main rule under Part B of Chapter 17. Every distinct offense has to be tried separately. The Section 219, 220, 221, and 223 are exceptions to this main rule. So main rule is separate charge and separate trial for every distinct offense. Now we'll pass on to certain questions, which will make the position very clear. Question number one on Section 218.
What is the scope of Section 218 CRPC?
Section 218 CRPC provides that for every distinct offence, there shall be separate charge and every charge shall be tried separately. Unless the accused person by a written application decides a joint trial of all such charges. If he makes a written application, then you don't have to resort to Section 218. You can depart from Section 218 if the accused makes a written application. Written application, mind you, not even oral application. Now, there's a beautiful decision by a three-judge bench of the Supreme Court. Recent decisions are authored by Dr. D.Y. Chandrachud. Para 31 of Naseeb Singh versus State of Punjab. I am giving you the live law citation. Live law 2021 by Supreme Court 552, three judges. Naseeb Singh versus State of Punjab. Again, decisions are only from Punjab. Maybe because of the proximity to Supreme Court. Or the number of crimes being more. The scope of Section 218 rights has been summarized in para 31 of Naseeb Singh. I will read that summing up of Section 218. A separate trial is not contrary to law, even if a joint trial, there is some disturbance. A separate trial is not contrary to law, even if a joint trial for the offences along with other offences is permissible. For example, even if the case falls under any of the exceptions to Section 218, separate trial is a rule, general rule. Therefore, even in a case where there can be a joint trial, if there is a separate trial, there can't be a violation. Then second rule is the possibility of a joint trial has to be decided at the beginning of the trial and not on the basis of the result of the trial. Second proposition laid down in Naseeb Singh. Third, the true test is whether any prejudice has been sustained as a result of separate trial. In other words, a retrial with a direction of a joint trial would be ordered only if there is failure of justice. Unless there is failure of justice or prejudice suffered by the accused, court will not order a retrial. Once you order a retrial, whatever trial that has already gone in will be effaced. It will go out of record. That is why the retrial is an exception. It is very sparingly done by courts. Because whatever evidence already come on record, will have to be effaced. Therefore, retrial is very seldom is not sparingly ordered. The test is whether any prejudice has been sustained as a result of separate trial. In other words, a retrial with a direction of a joint trial would be ordered only if there is failure of justice or prejudice being made out by the accused. Para 36 also of Naseeb Singh, 31 and 36. Then there is one more. A proposition covered by Chandra Bhai.
Just for him. Abhishek.
Covered by Chandra Bhai versus State of UP, 1971, Volume 3, SEC 983. 1971, Volume 3, SEC 983. Author of the judgment is Justice I.D. Dua. The exceptions, namely sections 219 to 221 and 223, so the rule of separate trial as contained in section 218 CRPC.
Just hold on, I will check from where the sound is coming. Yes, sir. No, it's fine.
Okay. Now, the fourth proposition, which is not discernible in Naseeb Singh's case, but then it is discernible in Chandra Bhai versus State of UP 1971, Volume 3, SEC 983. Again, it is repeated in by Justice Roynton Nariman in SR Tele Holdings Limited versus CBI 2015, Volume 10, SEC 562. 2015, Volume 10, SEC 562. That fourth proposal is the expressions, the exceptions to section 218, namely sections 219 to 221 and 223, to the rule of separate trial as contained in section 218, do not make joint trial mandatory in those situations barring or prohibiting separate trials. So even if the case falls under the exceptions, a separate trial will not be illegal, because those exceptions allowing joint trial will not render a separate trial illegal. That has to be taken note of. We pass on to question two.
Yes, sir. So what is the object of section 218 CRPC?
The object of section 218 CRPC is to save the accused from being embarrassed in his defense if distinct offenses are lumped together in one charge or in separate charges and tried together. It will be a sort of a mixture of all charges dumped together. So he will suffer prejudice. So he will be put to a misjoinder of charges, etc. That it is to save the accused from he may have to apply his mind to each and every charges. All of them have been dumped together. So it is to save the accused from such a predicament that the section 18, which directs separate trial for distinct offense, has been said. Aftab Ahmad Khan versus State of Haryana. State of Hyderabad. 1954 Supreme Court 386. AR 1954 Supreme Court 436. Page 436. Three judges. B.K. Mukherjee, Vivian Bose, and Ghulam Hassan. Author of the judgment is Justice Ghulam Hassan. Aftab Ahmad Khan versus State of Hyderabad, AR 1954, Supreme Court, 436, three judges. So it is to save the accused from being embarrassed in his defense, that this rule of separate trial in section 218 has been enunciated. Question three.
What do you mean by misjoinder of charges?
This is a very common expression used very often during trial. Section 218 CRPC is under the heading joinder of charges. See, part B, joinder of part B in section chapter 17 says joinder of charges, starting with section 218 to 224. Therefore, if the joinder of charges is in contravention of the procedure prescribed under section 218, then you can call it a misjoinder of charges. Because 218 is the pilot section for joinder of charges. If that pilot section is contravened, is violated, then you, and instead of separate charge, there's a joint trial made in respect of offense, distinct and different offenses, then you can say that it amounts to misjoinder of charges. Kamalananta versus State of Tamil Nadu. AIR 2005 Supreme Court 2132. AIR 2005 Supreme Court 2132, H.K. Sema. Author of the judgment is H.K. Sema, Justice H.K. Sema. Then under section 218.1, every distinct offense is to be charged and tried separately, and breach of this provision amounts to misjoinder of charges, unless the case falls under any of the exceptions, namely 219 to 221 and 223. But we have already noted that even if the case falls under any of the exceptions, which enable joint trial, if separate trial is done or is conducted, you can't call it illegal, because that is the main rule under 280. Question number four.
Jasleen.
Question four.
Am I audible, sir?
Yes.
What is the rule under section 218 CRPC, and are there exceptions to the said rule?
We have already seen that the rule under section 218.1 CRPC is that separate charges and separate trial for distinct offenses. The rule under 218.1 is that there should be separate charges and separate trial for distinct offenses. We have already seen. Exceptions are one, section 219. Three offenses of the same kind within 1 year. can be charged together. Three offenses of the same kind within a period of 1 year can be charged together under section 290. Then 220, section 220, more than one offense committed during same transaction may be charged at the same trial. More than one offense, but committed at the same trial, same transaction. Say if the transaction is same, more than one offense, for example, 323, 324, 326, 307, 302, all committed in the same transaction, they can be charged together. Then 221, where it is doubtful as to which offense has been committed. When the court is in doubt as to which exactly, which offense is exactly committed, then also court can have a joint trial. Then last exception is section 223. Class of persons who may be charged. Till now we saw the offenses. Now the class of persons who may be jointly tried, charged jointly. Kadri Kunyamad versus State of Madras, AR 1960 Supreme Court, page 661. It's a three-judge bench. Author of the judgment is P.B. Gajendra Gadkar. The other judges were Justice Sarkar and Subba Rao, all great judges. Again, Naseeb Singh, it has been repeated in para 38. Naseeb Singh versus State of Punjab. Live Law 2021, Supreme Court 552, three judges. Author of the judgment is Justice D.Y. Chandra, Dr. Justice D.Y. Chandrachud. In fact, His Lordship has summed up the position in this fashion. Section 218 provides that separate trials shall be conducted for distinct offences alleged to be committed by a person. Sections 219 to 221 provide exceptions to this general rule. In fact, it is not merely 221, 223 also. It's an omission. If a person falls under these exceptions, then a joint trial for the offences which a person is charged with may be conducted. Similarly, under section 223, a joint trial may be held for persons charged with different offences if any of the clauses of the provision are separately or in combination satisfied. Then second proposition is, while applying the principles enunciated in section 218 to 223 on conducting joint and separate trials, the trial court should apply two-pronged tests. A two-pronged test is to be applied by trial court. And appellate court also will have to see whether the trial court applied this two-pronged test. One, whether conducting a joint or separate trial will prejudice the defense of the accused. Whether by conducting either joint trial or separate trial, the defense of the accused would be prejudiced. First test. Second test, whether conducting a joint or separate trial would cause judicial delay. If by conducting a separate trial, it will unnecessarily cause judicial delay, then also, that is also a main consideration of the trial court while ordering a joint trial. Third proposition is, the possibility of conducting a joint trial will have to be determined at the beginning of the trial and not after the trial based on the result of the trial. The appellate court may determine the validity of the argument that there ought to have been a separate or joint trial only based on whether the trial had prejudiced the right of the accused or the prosecution. Because after the conviction or by the trial court, if the accused comes up in appeal and raises this point before the appellate court also will have to consider whether he has really suffered a prejudice or whether he is putting forward this argument just for the purpose of
delaying
the overtake or overriding the or to get over the conviction already sustained by him. Fourth proposition is, since the provisions which engraft an exception use the phrase may and not shall with reference to conducting a joint trial, a separate trial is usually not contrary to law, even if a joint trial could be conducted. Therefore, even if the case falls under the exceptions to section 218, namely 219, 220, 221, 223, where joint trial is permitted. Even if the case falls under any of these exceptions, the court conducted a separate trial, you can't blame. it is not illegal because it is the main rule, the general rule is followed. Therefore, unless it causes a miscarriage of justice, that's what the three judges held. Unless it causes miscarriage of justice or failure of justice. Last proposition is a conviction or acquittal of the accused cannot be set aside on the mere ground that there was a possibility of joint trial or separate trial, because it's all over. You are coming after the fair before the appellate court. Therefore, the possibility of a joint trial instead of separate trial, or a separate trial instead of joint trial, is not a ground for toppling or setting aside the conviction, because you are the accused is before the appellate court at the post-conviction stage. Therefore, on a mere technicality, on the ground of mere ground that there was a possibility of joint trial or a possibility of separate trial, he cannot waive with the court, because to set aside the order of conviction or acquittal, it must be proved that the rights of the parties were prejudiced because of joint or separate trial. Same applies in the case of appeal by prosecution also. Supposing the prosecution comes up in appeal against an order of acquittal and contends that this is a fit case where joint trial should have been done. Instead, the court below, the trial court, made a separate trial. No, that will not be ordinarily entertained by the appellate court unless the person or the party appealing, the party who is raising this contention, is able to show that that party was able to had suffered prejudice or miscarriage of justice. Because ordinarily, this is an irregularity which is curable under Section 465 CRPC. An irregularity curable under Section 465 CRPC. Will not go to the root of the jurisdiction. Will not go to the root of the matter. Will not affect the. It is not a case of inherent lack of jurisdiction. Question 5.
Are two interrelated offences distinct offences within the meaning of Section 218 CRPC?
Because what Section 218 says is distinct offences. Now, are interrelated offences distinct offences? Ordinarily, no. And it would depend upon the circumstances of the case in which the offences were committed to decide whether there should be separate charges or joint trial, etc. Beautifully explained by Raghubar Dayal, Justice Raghubar Dayal, in Banwarilal Junjunwala, Banwarilal Junjunwala versus Union of India, AR 1963 Supreme Court 1620. Here about 19 instances of cheating were committed by presenting separate bills, and it was contended on behalf of the accused that there should have been separate trial and separate charge for each instance of cheating and for each presentation of bill. There should have been separate charge of cheating for each of the charge, instead of one omnibus charge of cheating in pursuance of criminal conspiracy alleged. This was the argument raised, but Supreme Court repelled the argument by saying that no, you can't just because though it is an omnibus charge, it was an offense of cheating committed pursuant to a criminal conspiracy. Therefore, the conspiracy binds all those transactions. It is all done in pursuance of the criminal conspiracy committed by all the accused together. Therefore, no prejudice is suffered by the accused on account of the want of separate charge of cheating for each of the presentation of bills. Question 6.
There was a charge of criminal conspiracy to commit criminal breach of trust. There was also a charge of criminal breach of trust under Section 409 of IPC. In pursuance of the charge of criminal conspiracy, the prosecution fails to establish criminal conspiracy. Now, can the accused be convicted of the offense of criminal breach of trust alone?
Nothing wrong. Since the accused was aware that there was a substantive charge under Section 409 IPC, he cannot put forward a grievance of prejudice. This is what the Supreme Court said in Madan Lal versus State of Punjab, AR 1967 Supreme Court 1590. Author of the judgment is Justice J.M. Shelat. AR 1967 Supreme Court 1590. in para 7 holds that a decision, a division bench ruling of the Kerala High Court reported in AR 1963 Kerala 68 is directly contrary to the principle laid down by the Constitution bench in Williams Lanny's case, AR 1956 Supreme Court 116 Constitution bench, which we started this series with Williams Lanny's case. That is the Bible of every charge and discharge, every case of charge and discharge. So if one can master Williams Lanny's case, you can easily get over every contention based on irregular charge or improper discharge, etc. Question number 7.
Can it be presumed that the accused apprehended no prejudice in the case where he had not raised any objection to the joint trial before the trial court?
Yes, it can be presumed because the Constitution bench relied on Section 537 of the old code corresponding to Section 465 CRPC to repel the contention of prejudice raised belatedly by the accused. At the appropriate time, he did not raise any argument of prejudice. And he raised that at the belated stage in the appeal before the Supreme Court. Therefore, it can be presumed, Supreme Court said, it can be presumed that he did not suffer any prejudice. If he was suffering prejudice, he should have raised it at the earliest opportunity during trial, which he did not do. Mangaldas Raghavji Ruparel was the state of Maharashtra. AR 1966 Supreme Court 128. AR 1966 Supreme Court 128. The Constitution bench decision, the author of the verdict is Justice Madholkar.
So it is akin to what we say that you have submitted to the jurisdiction, like in arbitration, yes, etc. Yes. You don't submit your objection regarding jurisdiction.
And it amounts to almost waiver, so virtually a waiver. Because you have the right to object, but you don't do that. And you raise it only before the appellate court for the first time. At the earliest opportunity, you should have raised it. Then the court would have considered that. Instead of doing that, you suffered the so-called prejudice and suffered a conviction also. Now you are coming before the appellate court and complaining that there was prejudice. No, it will stand cured under Section 465 CRPC. Question 8.
What is the normal rule under CRPC with regard to each accused when the offense committed by him is distinct and separate?
The normal rule under Section 218 CRPC, 218, I said it is the general rule, is separate charge and separate trial. 219 and 220, sections 219 to 223 are exceptions that would indicate joint trial is an exception. This was again reiterated by a three judges bench. The judgment rendered by author of the judgment is H.R. Khanna, famous H.R. Khanna. V.N. Kamdar versus M.C.D. V.M. Kamdar versus M.C.D. 1973, AR 1973 Supreme Court, page 22. Three judges. Author of the judgment is H.R. Khanna. AR 1973 Supreme Court, 22. Therefore, the only rule is separate trial. Separate charge and separate trial for distinct offenses. But and a joint trial under Section 290, 220, 221, and 223 is an exception. Question 9.
Where the separate charges were tried separately, is it not open to the appellate court to refer to the evidence in cross cases?
There are two cross cases. For example, there will be a main case and a counter case. What is a case and counter? Case and counter are only rival versions of the same occurrence. Case and counter are only rival versions of the same occurrence. A party will be alleging that B party were the aggressors. B party will be alleging that A party will be the aggressors. So both sides will be giving FIR, will be getting their FIR registered, and there will be an investigation. There can be a situation where one case ends in a charge sheet, another case ends in a closure report. There can be a situation where both cases end in a closure report. There can be a situation where one case, which is the usual situation, one case ends in a charge sheet and the other case ends in a closure report. So the party who suffered the closure report, may take up the matter in appeal. The beauty of this case and counter is that both cases should be tried by the same judge, same court. Both cases should be tried by the same court. Because you this there is only one occurrence. There's only one place of occurrence. There's only one occurrence, one incident. We have only two rival versions of the party. The same judge alone can find out who, which party was the aggressor and which party was on the receiving end, all those things. But both are separate cases. The evidence in one case cannot be imported into the other. And the evidence in the other case cannot be imported in the main case. That is the beauty of this. Though the same judge is trying both cases, because same judge can have the privilege of the evidence, the overall evidence in the case. But the case in the evidence in the counter in the main case cannot be imported into the counter case. The evidence in the counter case cannot be imported into the main case. Even when the matter goes up in appeal, the position of the appellate court is also same. Appellate court also can, if the appellate court is hearing an appeal against the main case, it cannot look into the evidence in the counter case. The citations are Mithulal versus State of Madhya Pradesh, AR 1975 Supreme Court 149. Mithulal versus State of Madhya Pradesh, AR 1975 Supreme Court 149, page 149. And there's a Kerala full bench, Kerala decision. Achyuthan versus Bapu, 1961 KLT 412. And there is a full bench decision of the Kerala High Court. Augustine versus State, 1982 KLT 351 full bench. Judgment rendered by Justice Janigema, late Justice Janigema. In fact, one beauty of case and counter is, very often in murder cases, there will be a counter case also. There are. Murder case may will have to be tried by the session judge. Because 302, exclusively tribal by a court of session. So murder case may be pending before the session judge. Maybe during trial or just before trial that it would be informed that there is a counter case also. But all are magisterial offenses pending before a magistrate court. Then the judge made law is that both cases should be tried by the same court. So the magistrate cannot try the session case. Whereas session judge can try the magisterial offences. But the case before the pending before the magistrate should come to the session court. So there have been cases where the session judges had withdrawn the case before the magistrate court to the session court for being tried together. But withdrawal cannot be done. Transfer also cannot be done. A transfer of a case pending before the magistrate court to the session court cannot be done because of 193 CRPC. 193 CRPC says no court of session shall take cognizance of an offense as a court of original jurisdiction unless the case is committed to the court of session. So the case has to be committed to the court of session by virtue of the power under section 209 CRPC. The concerned magistrate will have to commit the case to the court of session. Session court cannot take cognizance without a committal. Only there is only one or two exceptions in the CRPC and certain other laws. Otherwise, all session judges can take cognizance only on a committal. Now, here is a counter case, of course, involving magisterial offenses pending before a magistrate. You want that case also to be tried along with the sessions case pending before the session court. So the proper procedure is to commit the case. Now, can a magistrate, without reference to 209, commit the case pending before him? 323, section 323 is the provision. Under section 323, even if the offences are not exclusively triable by a court of session, if the magistrate is of the view that this case ought to be tried by a session court, magistrate can commit the case by virtue of his power under, in exercise of his power under section 323 CRPC. And commit the case to the court of session. And court of session can try both the cases as a counter and case and counter. So when we refer to case and counter, and the evidence in one case cannot be looked into by the court in the other case. That is always to be borne in mind. Yes. Question number 10.
The charge is conspiracy to commit an offense followed by a charge in respect of that offense as well. Conspiracy is not established and accused is acquitted of the offense of conspiracy. Can the accused be convicted in respect of the substantive offense?
See, what is conspiracy? conspiracy is meeting of by two or more persons for the purpose of committing an offense. Now, the conspiracy is not established. Here is a case where certain offenses are committed in pursuance of the criminal conspiracy, but conspiracy is not established. Then can the accused be convicted for the other offense, which is not shown to have been done in pursuance of the criminal conspiracy? Can it be done? That's a beautiful question. It can be.
It can be.
Can be. There can't be any doubt. There can't be any doubt, because whether conspiracy or not, there is a criminal offense committed. An offense has been committed. So it can be done. T. Shankar Prasad versus State of Andhra Pradesh. T. Shankar Prasad versus State of Andhra Pradesh. AIR 2004 Supreme Court 1242. 1242. AIR 2004 Supreme Court 1242. Author of the judgment is Justice Arijit Pasai. Yes. Question number 11.
The charge is criminal conspiracy to commit a particular offense. Prosecution failed to prove that particular offense. Can there be conviction for criminal conspiracy alone?
Now, see, this is the converse of the earlier question. Earlier question, the criminal conspiracy alleged was not proved, but the offense committed in pursuance of the criminal conspiracy was there. Evidence was there. So court said he can be convicted. Now, here is a case where the offense is not proved, but the criminal conspiracy is proved, but the offense committed in pursuance of the criminal conspiracy is not proved. So can he be convicted for criminal conspiracy alone?
No.
I am afraid that you are wrong. So criminal conspiracy is an independent and distinct offense. Whether the offense in pursuance of the criminal conspiracy has been committed or not, notwithstanding the fact that the other offense has not been committed, the offense of criminal conspiracy, for which they assembled together, they conspired together, they can be separately tried. Venkatakrishnan versus CBI, 2009, volume 11, SEC 737. 2009, volume 11, SEC 737. Volume 11, SEC 737. Please note, because very often judicial officers commit mistakes. Oh, when criminal conspiracy alone is proved, is made out, the other offense is not proved. Where is the question of the offense being committed in pursuance of a criminal conspiracy? There cannot be a conviction for, unlike, as in the case of section 149, as between 149 and 34, vicarious liability, constructive liability. We saw that while 34 is not a distinct offense, section 149 itself is a distinct offense. Likewise, criminal conspiracy punishable under section 120 capital A, 120B CRPC is a distinct offense, whether the other offense is committed or not. Please bear this in mind. Here, this is the case. Venkatakrishnan is that case where the case of criminal conspiracy and collusion between late Harshad Mehta and certain bank officials, wherein Harshad Mehta was allowed to obtain 40 crores of rupees, which was actually call money given as loan by National Housing Bank to UCO Bank. This is Harshad Mehta's case. So it was held that, notwithstanding the fact that the other offense has not been proved, criminal conspiracy, if made out, can be the subject matter of conviction separately. Question 12.
The overt acts committed pursuant to the criminal conspiracy were committed beyond the jurisdiction of the court having jurisdiction to try the offense of criminal conspiracy. Can that court try the other offenses?
That is, criminal conspiracy is triable before this court, because criminal conspiracy took place within the local limits of this court. The subsequent offense committed were beyond the territorial limits of this court. Now, can the court try the other offenses? Other offenses committed beyond the territorial limits of the court, within whose limits the criminal conspiracy was committed.
It can, sir. The conspiracy was hatched in its jurisdiction to commit that.
You are absolutely right. You are absolutely right. This is a case of cause and effect. Cause and effect, part of the same transaction, virtually part of the same transaction. Pursuant to the conspiracy, the other offenses, you cannot segregate the two, segregate between the two. Even if the court does not have territorial jurisdiction to try the other offenses, if criminal conspiracy was committed within the local limits of the court, then court can try that offense. R.K. Dalmia versus Delhi administration. R.K. Dalmia versus Delhi administration. A.R. 1962 Supreme Court 1821. A.R. 1962 Supreme Court 1821. Raghubar Dayal, Justice Raghubar Dayal, author of the judgment. Three judges. Again, Purushottam Das Dalmia versus State of West Bengal. A.R. 1961 Supreme Court 1589. A.R. 1961 Supreme Court 1589. Again, Raghubar Dayal. Justice Raghubar Dayal is the author of the judgment. Then we come to the last question for today.
So last is, court is having jurisdiction to try offenses committed in pursuance of the criminal conspiracy. But the offense of criminal conspiracy was committed outside the territorial jurisdiction. Can that court also try the offense of criminal conspiracy?
This is a converse of the earlier question. Here, the offense committed, the court is having jurisdiction, territorial jurisdiction to try the offenses. Rather, the offenses pursuant to the criminal conspiracy were committed within the local limits of the court. But criminal conspiracy was committed beyond the territorial limits of the court. Same principle, cause and effect, same principle. L.N. Mukherjee versus State of Madras. L.N. Mukherjee versus State of Madras. A.R. 1961 Supreme Court, 1601. A.R. 1961 Supreme Court, 1601. Again, Raghubar Dayal. I think this judge is an expert on criminal conspiracy. Raghubar Dayal. Three judges, three judgments. Raghubar Dayal, A.R. 1961 Supreme Court, 1601. With that, we conclude the questions on section 218. Now, hereafter, we will be looking into the other section, 219 to 224. Maybe in one session or more than one session, because it depends on the number of questions for you to understand the section, the scope of the section.
One, what you are writing a book, somebody has posted on the YouTube. Ram Kumar, sir, please compile a textbook with the treasure of your knowledge in question and answer form.
These are all parts of my book only.
this is having a visual effect and the effect of
exactly. Mind. Yeah, I have taken physically lifted from my book and presenting it before you. So they find the same thing in my book.
And they say that it carries more impact.
Unless the law is changed subsequently, either the statute law or the judge made law.
Yeah, law keeps on changing with the flux of time.
Yes.
I normally speak, one of the lawyer has written in his office, once you enter his office, law is what the judge decides on that particular day.
Yes.
Because it can evolve. We have
Justice Krishna used to say, law is what the judges say it is.
Yeah. So, I will request Mr. Rao to
say the only thing constant is change.
Yeah. So, Mr. Rao, a vote of thanks on your side, from your side.
Good evening, everybody. I mean, it's a pleasure to hear Justice Ram Kumar. He's a treasure trove, and I think we should keep digging deeper every day. And the pearls of wisdom, and especially the way he explains, the way we interact also sometimes with him. I mean, it's really great of him because for a judge to take questions or from a common person like us and not feel offended, but to try and explain it to us, plays a greater role. And today, thanks to the web, we all are able to come together from different parts of the country. I mean, today we all are from different parts of the country. I mean, to organize one seminar, it'll be restricted to that area itself. But we need to thank the web and more Justice Ram Kumar for taking the time out to come and explain both the practice and the theoretical aspects of each and every section. I mean, like I keep saying, I mean, every day or every lecture that we hear from him, we have enhanced our knowledge at least by 10%, which is a very big thing. And like, just as Vikas said, the book, in fact, the person speaking and explaining to us is much better than just reading through the book. Because our doubts may not be answered, but here your doubts are being answered, and that plays an important part. And I once again thanks Justice Ram Kumar, Live Law, Vikas Chatrath, Jasleen Kaur, and the others who participated today. I mean, it's really nice to be on this platform. I love to be here, and I thank everybody once again.
Thank you, Mr. KV Jarao.
I will just add that what you said, books are a one-way traffic. Whereas when once we are acting on a for a webinar, etc., it's not only two-way traffic, but it's a multiple process. You learn from everyone. So that's a pleasure. And somebody like coming like this is Ram Kumar, who's an epitome of knowledge. And the way he simplifies the things.
I am just a small speck in the ocean of law.
No, but we are, but that speck is also pearl.
It's the sparkle of the diamond, sir. The diamond doesn't matter. Which corner sparkles is more important for us. And that gives us the light. So that's what we look at.
Thank you.
Consistency, clarity, and conviction. That is the hallmark of Justice Ram Kumar.
And communication.
Any law is better understood when you actually apply the law to given concrete situations. So what you see, what you have in the court, I am only giving this, these problems so that when you apply these, the law, law to this given set of facts, you know the law better.
That's what they say, that watching a match and playing a match is already a different ballgame.
Different. Theory and practical.
That's true. Thank you, everyone. Stay safe. Stay blessed.